Let's, we had a little bit of problem with some things here with the, some connections someplace. Let's open with prayer. Father, thank you for the day. Please continue to meet the needs that we have. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so we have here the quiz from last time. Jacob, question one, please. Good. Thank you, Jacob. That's right. John, number two, please.
In what city did Polycarp serve as pastor? That would be Smyrna.
Smyrna, that's right.
Which is in Asia Minor.
It is. Bill.
What four names does Wilkinson associate with heavy, with heresy and corruption? That would be Justin Martyr, Tatian, Clement of Alexandria, and Origen.
Tammy, number four. That's correct.
Who presented the Christian message in philosophical terms?
That was Justin Martyr. All right. Anna, number five, please.
I didn't do the quiz.
Okay. Mrs. Grummer, number five. That's good. That's right. Jacob, next one, please.
That was five. So, all right, that was six.
I did five.
Yeah, you said number six, Jacob. Yeah, number six.
Concerns about the scriptures being altered. Dionysius.
Good. That's right. John, number seven.
One. What disciple of Polycarp accused heretics of corrupting the scriptures? That would be Irenaeus. And two, who quoted from the last 12 verses of Mark, as well as every New Testament book, with the exception of Philemon and 3 John, also Irenaeus.
Good. He's got the both answers, or both part one and part two are the same person. Yeah. Bill, number eight, please.
From where did Polycarp obtain his copy of the New Testament book of Revelation? From his teacher, the Apostle John.
That's right. Number nine, Tammy.
What city in North Africa did Tertullian once live? That was in Carthage, which was modern-day Tunisia. And two, why did he believe heretics altered the scripture? Because they wanted to gain support for their special views.
Mm-hmm. Mrs. Grummer, number 10, please.
I think Anna could do that.
Anna could do that one.
Oh, number 10.
Yeah.
Number 10. Number 10 is... who states clearly that Tertullian references 1 John 5, 7?
Who states clearly that
Mrs. Grummer, this is a question for Anna. This one she should know the answer to.
This was Dr. D.A. Wade, although I'm sure many have mentioned it.
Okay, that's good. Number 11, Mrs. Grummer, I'm sorry. That's right. That's part one. And Jake, you want to help with part two?
Oh, okay. And part two is he had the greatest corrupting influence on the early church and the Bible itself than any other man.
That's good. John number 12, please.
One, according to Miller's, what did Origen attempt to synchronize? That would be the pagan philosophies with Christian teachings. And two, what horrible movement is he the father of, Arianism? And three, what false concept or place did he develop? That would be purgatory.
All right, that's right. Tammy, number 13, please.
According to Reuman, who had a team of scribes whose purpose was to correct the manuscripts? Origen.
Good. Number 14, Mrs. Grummer.
In what day did Edward Miller disprove the false notion of Hoyt's view about Origen and the Textus Receptus? And number two, according to the Hills, what version of his origin is difficult to maintain? Okay. Oh dear, I didn't get that one.
All right, Jacob, you want to help her out with this one? It was probably not the best worded question. I know there's some of these questions aren't worded very like they should be, but so help her out, Jacob.
Let me see. Page, I'll read from page 92, paragraph 5 and 6. Let me see where this starts here. Okay, Hort stated regarding Origen, his scripture quotations to be the best of our belief exhibit no clear tangible trace of the TR. However, Edward Miller, in his exhaustive study of the Fathers, found that Origen sided with the TR 460 times and with the Westcott and Hort 491 times. This is a powerful proof that even in Alexandria at this early date, the distinctive readings of the received text were almost as common as that of the other. Hill states in the first 14 chapters of the Gospel of John, that is in the area covered by P66, out of the 52 instances in which Textus Receptus stands alone, Origen agrees with it 20 times and disagrees with 30 times. Thus, to assertion that Origen knew nothing of the TR becomes difficult indeed to maintain.
Good, Jacob. John 15, please.
15. What two men did Origen wrongly influence in Caesarea? Eusebius and Jerome.
Eusebius and Jerome. Bill, 16, please.
What father of church history worshipped at the altar of Origen's teachings? And two, whose library did he preserve? Well, for one, it would be Eusebius, and then on the second part, Origen's at Caesarea.
All right, and number 17, Tammy.
What did Ibn Damasus commission Jerome to do in the year 382 to revise the Latin Bible?
Good. 18, Mrs. Grummer. Well, maybe Miss, maybe Anna can get this one. Mrs. Grummer, maybe Anna can get 18 second. Let me see if she can. What books did Origen wrongly place on equal footing with the words of God? And what doctrines of his were placed on equal authority with the scripture?
Does this have to do with the Apocrypha and Purgatory?
Yes. That's right.
Yeah,
got the answer.
I had to add another.
What's the second part of it?
Well, you have the
purgatory and
another teaching of his, transubstantiation.
Transubstantiation.
Tradition in general.
And tradition in general. That's good. All right, Mrs. Grummer, you get 19, please.
Whose text is the foundation of most modern biblical versions today? Origen.
Good, that's right. All right, Jacob, number 20, you have to find the missing... Anyway, number 20 is missing a T, but go ahead.
Find the missing one? I'm not looking for a missing link. Well, on the back of this quiz, please explain how important the importance of rejecting the key pillars in Westcott and Hort. They should be rejected because these men were pagan, Gnostic, Antichrist, and not saved and born again, according to John chapter 3:3-5, John 1:12-13, and not born of the living and written word of God, 1 Peter 1:23. not in Hort, we're very anti-Christ.
How about you, John? What do you get for 20?
Good. I didn't even do that one, but I can do it quickly.
Okay, that's fine.
I just assumed it was like the other that last one was a, you know, what you found. On the back of this quiz, we said, the importance of rejecting the key pillars of Wisconsin Hort, well, it denies all the fundamentals of the faith.
Okay, that's right.
So, mm-hmm. You know, which means if you accept the Wisconsin Hort text, you're denying the deity of Christ, you're denying the inspiration of Scripture, you're denying the preservation of Scripture. These mm-hmm. are key fundamental that obviously we need to have. If not, then there's no sense. The Bible's worthless.
Right, that's right.
If you can't, mm-hmm. if it's not truly God's Word and you can't rely upon it, then what, we might as well just go ahead and, you know, read the writings of Confucius or
That's right. You know, just another book.
Yeah,
you know.
Just another book.
But it's not. That's why we have to reject it.
Right. Bill.
Well, I'm amazed that Westcott and Hort would put their own views and their own biases in front of Scripture.
Mm-hmm.
That their wants and their desires are just like Satan's.
Mm-hmm.
They place their own words above God as being more relevant and more important than God's.
Right.
And somehow they are able to convince themselves that their words offer salvation.
Mm-hmm.
If they actually care about that at all.
Right.
Anyway,
mm-hmm.
we don't really know. But I'm just amazed that when we have a choice between God's word or man's word, and we know that man's word contains a lot of errors, and we're subject to stumble all of the time. God has never made a mistake.
Mm.
He's made everything that exists in the universe. He can, if he can do all of that, then he can certainly write a Bible without any mistakes at all.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that's I don't see you know why a man should resist it, but apparently they mm-hmm. do. Satan did, hath God said.
Mm-hmm, that's right. Tammy, what do you get for 20?
Well, I was just thinking about how the key pillars of Westcott and Hort are all based on the denial of the biblical authority of Scripture.
Mm-hmm.
And then they depend upon you know, humanism and naturalistic approaches to the Scripture.
Right.
You know, it's important that we reject their pillars, because
mm-hmm.
if we do that, you know, I mean, let me get back to what I said here, because they don't revere the Scriptures as divine authority, their conclusions are all wrong without their false pillars, is what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
Their appeal to Bible-believing Christians, which was apparently who they, some of the people they first appealed to back in the 1800s. And, in fact, their whole theory is going to fall. So
mm-hmm.
that's why it's important that I don't believe their
mm-hmm. pillars. That's right. And Annie, you want to try answer number 20? How important is it to reject the key pillars of Westcott and Hort?
Very important.
Good, very important. That's good. And the space provided, okay, so... But yeah, you didn't realize you were right in the back of the paper.
Well, you just asked how
yes.
important that
is. Yes, it is. It is very important. I think it is very important. Yes, we must reject them. Now,
I was taking a very strict interpretation of the question.
Okay.
He encouraged us to go on to the back of the page.
Yes.
And write.
so, in this.
So I just came up with that.
In this next. In this next section here, deals with the some research of Bergon and of Miller, and getting quotes from the patristic fathers. But and what Bergon did, he gathered over 8,600 quotations and evidence of Scripture. 86,000. That's right. 86,000. Did I say 86?
You said 8,600.
Oh, 8,600, thank you. 86,000. 86,000 places where different people who lived before 400 AD quoted from the Scripture that Origen, alleged Origen and West Conroy alleged did not exist. Alleged that were products of conflation. But this is what's 16 volumes, a 16 volume set that he has. From what I understand, it's all color coded. And Tammy, you remember some things about this document that we heard Dr. Mormon talking about this recently, about the 16 volume set that was in the British Museum.
Yeah.
How it was archived, or it was in the kind of put in a very special place in the museum. Weren't you talking about that recently? It was, but weren't you discussing it? As far as what do you know about it?
Well, he would have to go there and look at it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
He had to go there because those volumes were all at the British Museum. They were like a prestige.
Yes.
Bible or a prestige document in that case.
An under lock and key, almost. Yeah, exactly. Under lock and key.
It's like something that you couldn't. Mm-hmm. Just go and look at too freely.
And so
he did look at it, I think.
Yeah,
but he had. I mean, anyone just can't go.
No, I think it's all color coded somehow.
Okay.
I from what I understand, it's all color coded in ways you can look at it and kind of see what goes where and who did it. And it's very. I mean, I haven't seen it myself, but it'd be interesting to be able to. Get a thorough understanding of what it's all about. We do. We have in his 8,000 differences, in different works, we do have what Bergen has, but it's not in this great detail. John?
I was going to say, that'd be a nice set to have reprinted.
Yes, it would. Yeah, we got to get that. We that was one of the objectives of the society, to do that. Maybe it could be done now that we have other technology and we don't have to print thousands at a time. We could print one at a time. Okay, good. We got somebody that's going to buy one.
That's right.
Yeah, well, I don't know if they can do. I don't think they can do that.
Yeah.
You know?
According to what he was saying.
Mm-hmm.
Was it in here? I thought it was in here.
It probably was.
But maybe.
Or maybe it was in that other book. I don't know.
I could. Well, mm-hmm. I could have been looking in different places. I don't remember. It was a couple of weeks ago, I think.
And so, what he has done, what Bergen. Accomplished in this big, huge task he undertook, he categorizes as far as what you know. You have the documents that are either the for instance, you know the B, the Aleph, the D, the A, the different manuscripts. And there's only a few, and papyri and all sorts of ones. He categorized them, and said this is how they come into relevance. Now. We notice that what Kenyon says here in this section that we read. Now Kenyon is taking a different view, I believe. Kenyon says, this is on page 94. Kenyon says the following about Miller's research: the results of his examination are stated by him as follows. Taking the Greek and Latin, not the Syriac fathers, who died before AD 400, though quotations are not found to support the TR in 2,630 instances. That is, distinctive TR readings, with the West Conroy is 1753. So,
they are found, aren't they?
They are found. I'm sorry, I said not. Yes. So, thank you. Thank you for the clarification.
I misunderstood yes. it when I read it the first
yes.
time.
No, I misunderstood. I misread it a moment ago. Yes, you're right. 2,600 times we have support for this, the TR readings, and only 1,700 times the support for the West Conroy readings. Now, as we see here on the next page, what Kenyon is trying to, propose or say, well, it's possible, he's saying, that the patristic fathers, their writings were altered. to reflect the TR readings, rather than saying that the text of Scripture was tampered by Westcott and Hort. He wants to say the writings of patristic fathers were tampered with, rather than the other way around. You understand what Kenyon is saying? Tammy? On page 94, I guess it is. See, that's the wrong approach. And Kenyon's wrong. And Kenyon, I think even Kenyon, later on in some places, you know, say that, you know, that's not quite, he can't really support that argument.
Yeah, well, he said that in that first quote.
But he suggests it. Well, he says, in the first quote, he gives support for it. But then later on, Kenyon is saying that, well, it's there because, for this reason. But Kenyon's wrong on that. It doesn't make any sense to say that the church, the patristic fathers' documentation, his writings were altered. It makes no sense whatsoever to say that. So they're stretching at a, they're trying to give every reason they can to keep the origin text, keep the text of Westcott and Hort.
Yeah, but anything that conforms to the Textus Receptus, that was doctored.
Right.
Anything else? Oh, no, that's
right.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
That's
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Summary.
Exactly. That's right. Now, we have Edward Miller doing some analysis with some things, some things that contradict which other thing. He came over 3,000 times. And what Pickering tries to emphasize with this, Wilbur Pickering, is that this is a confrontation or dispute just among the Gospels, and just among the Gospels alone. He said that on page 95, he says, it should be also noted that Miller's tabulation include only those readings which were either accepted as being part of the TR tradition or were accepted by Westcott and Hort in their critical text. Very readings outside of those were not included. Now, we have, he gives these range of dates of these patristic fathers. We have the 2nd century, 3rd century, the 4th century. We get the ones that are living from 95 to 100, and then we have the second part of the 2nd century from 150 to 200, and then 200 to 250, and 200 to 300. He lists all these different people, these names, and sometimes the actual works, some works that are that they've written. Now, on page 95, again, this is perhaps not quite accurate because we have Origen, because Origen lived past 200. But perhaps the word most is what is trying to be emphasized. He says on page 95, most, this is Mormon quoting somebody else, most tampering of the text took place before 200, and most was done in the western area furthest from the location of the original autographs. So the second part of that is a reasonable conclusion to make as far as both the western and the Alexandrian texts. Those were the ones that had the most corruption contained within them. But as far as the 200 mark, 200, perhaps I'm having a problem with the word most here. Maybe most is, I'm splitting hairs with most. But certainly we know that Origen, who lived after 200, had a hand in corrupting the text himself. We have both Coldwell and Kilpatrick who say similar things, and also Scrivener. But the point is, I think they're agreeing with the fact that the text was corrupted. Now, and as far as how much, you know, most is 50%, 51% most, I guess it would be. So that leaves another 49% for Origen. I don't know how the exact, I don't know what the percentages are, but it's we have to note the fact that Origen did have a heavy hand, heavy thumb on the corruption of the text. He says in 995, Coldwell says, the overwhelming majority of the variant readings were created before the year 200. Scrivener says, the worst corruptions of the New Testament has ever been subjected to originated within 100 years after it was composed. Kilpatrick says the creation of new variant readings ceased by 200 AD because it became impossible to sell them. And so Kilpatrick here is saying it ceased, but we know it didn't cease because of the fact that Origen still had his influence after that time period. As we said last week, we also talked about this, I believe, as far as the number of New Testament books, 18 to 24 of the New Testament books were written to Asia Minor and to Greece. So none of them really went into Alexandria, the Alexandria area. And so he's bringing this up and to say that the original autographs were in a certain particular region of the country, of the world. And then there's copies would have stayed there. So when the copies came to the Alexandria region, in the western region, that's where they became corrupt. You have a question, Tammy?
Well, I don't understand these three men that are all in agreement with this first 100 years. And then
especially Kilpatrick.
Origen. I don't know anything about them. I mean, I know it's Scrivener mm-hmm. a little bit, but I'm just wondering if they missed something. I mean, how could they come up with that?
Yeah, I'm not sure how they came up with it, especially
they
with...
They all seem to agree. Do you know anything about them?
Very little. I mean, I mean Scrivener is the only name that's recognizable. And we know about Scrivener. But he was... But yeah, we should find out more about them. John, how about you?
I'm thinking maybe... Scrivener says the worst corruptions happened within 100 years. I'm thinking maybe that's more the basis of the worst happened then. The last one says that creation of variants ceased by 200. We know that's not true. We know there were
right.
corruptions mm-hmm. since then. We look at Tischendorf and
right.
that, right?
Mm-hmm.
And how
right.
he doctored
mm-hmm.
Manuscripts. But, like Scrivener was saying, the worst mm-hmm. things happened. But it didn't all cease. That clear? Kind
I don't
of,
know. I guess I thought Origen was the he created the worst changes.
And I believe so
maybe,
too.
Maybe I'm missing yeah. something. Or maybe
not. I don't think you're missing
understand
anything.
These
yeah.
men where they're coming from. Yeah.
And so.
We'll have to read some of their materials and try to find out where
they. If
their
I can figure out who they are, some of them.
Well, oh. Scrivener, we can find. I've heard of Kilpatrick before.
I mean, it would help if his whole name was there. Then I mean, he may have mentioned him before. Probably he did. And,
where do you get copies of the writings of these early church fathers?
That's available. I have a whole set at home. The early church fathers set. About, yeah, my volumes.
Like 36 or something like that, maybe?
Yeah,
or,
something like that. Yeah. It's still available. Christian Book Distributors have it. It costs you about... $250 maybe, $250 for the whole set.
And so what you could do, you read those, and which what Bergon did, and he categorized. He's noticing, hey, these church fathers are quoting from the scripture, the TR reading. That does not reflected in West Cohort whatsoever. And so that's why that's what the point of the Pergans, the 16 volume work that he was doing. He's giving here's this church father, he's quoting from here and here and here this passage and this passage, and so that you could obtain copies of them today. I mean they're probably which some of them would have to be translated, I suppose.
A lot of computer software has them now. That's probably the cheapest way to go.
Mm-hmm.
I know Ages software is probably the cheapest. Just PDF
so it is really all available for anyone to look at then.
Yeah, the early church fathers said
right.
yeah,
mm-hmm.
yeah, it's quite easy to get.
Yeah, more so even now, today, you know, in our time.
Yeah, certainly with computer yeah. technology.
Right.
Well, the printing technology we have now, and then,
I mean, not to say it wasn't accessible to Bergon, but as far as today, we have even more access to him.
Right.
And he had access to him as well, but we have an even greater access to them today in all sorts of formats. If you notice on page 96, we see him saying, he says, since the confusion, which is most obvious in origin, is already observable in these men, from Origen to Marcius Magnus, early 300s, the advantage drops from 1.2 to 1. And so then he's given a ratio here. He's given you these ratio statistics of TR support and versus the Origen / Westcott Hort support of these readings. Now, who has 1 Corinthians 1:27? Okay.
God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty.
Okay. That's right, that's good. Now, he's bringing this verse up to say that we've observed this before as far as how has God preserved his words, especially with the New Testament, and it was the humbler believers, the priesthood of the believers. It wasn't some big ecclesiastical council, anything like that. It was a group but a body of the church itself was used in preserving the scripture in Bible prayers for the weak things of this world. Just the common humble people that were used by God to preserve the scripture. Now, there's I'm not really sure why Luther said this, but and what he actually means by this. But he called the church fathers babies. Anyone have any thoughts about what he meant by that?
Spiritually, they were babies.
Yes, that's good.
So they could be like intellectual giants.
Yes. Good point. That's a very good point. Spiritually speaking, they were babies, even though they could have been so-called intellectual giants.
Compared to their intellectual giantness, they were spiritually very weak.
Right.
And I mean, it can be quite the opposite with these common people, you know, that Dr. Mormon is referring to.
Yes.
Or Dr. Strauss, I guess, referred to as far as the humble believer.
Yes.
They could have great spiritual depth and not have a lot of intellectual.
Mm-hmm. That's right. That's good.
Same thing today with many, not just the scholars, but we see a lot of pastors coming out of these seminaries and stuff today.
Mm-hmm.
They may be intellectually knowledgeable, and they probably may be able to quote the Bible backwards and forwards just as well as anyone else, but spiritually or just don't have the knowledge that they have because they don't have the true gospel in them.
No.
You know, they're reading from corrupt texts. They're learning from corrupt things. They're not following the true word of God. They think it is, but they're off the mark.
Right.
You know, and the further they go with it, you know, you extrapolate it out, you see, they get further and away.
They do easily.
Yeah.
Easily. You know, and he points out before 400, the patristic fathers quoted from the TR front ratio of 3-2. So three times from the TR versus two times from the Origen type of text.
That's
on page 96, I believe.
And that was just the fathers of in the West.
Yes.
Quoting from those two sources.
Right.
What do we know about the fathers from the East?
It would have much. I would think it would be more TR, more TR support.
I think so too.
Yeah,
but
it should be.
Yeah.
We don't really refer to those people if we know even who they are.
No.
Except for Polycarp, of course.
I mean this is the problem with the family argument, you know, because you have it's an imbalance.
Yeah.
You would think that it's stronger right where the original autographs were, and they were. They were not copies of copies of copies. They were independent copies of the scripture. And then once they went to Alexandria, they just did what they want with them. The Gnostics and all the people that had strange views about various doctrines. You know, we mentioned from last time, transubstantiation, purgatory, all these horrible, wrong doctrine. Tammy?
Well, most of the church fathers that they listed in the previous section mm-hmm. that we read about, most, or the majority, I should say, were sort of, they were heretics.
Yes.
So they were spiritual babies in that sense.
They were. So Luther was right in that regard. You know, they had... They weren't just misunderstanding a couple areas of doctrine. They were twisting the scripture, and they wanted to go in a completely different direction.
Any heresy you want to find, you go to early church fathers, you can support it.
Right. And so, the TR was unified. It was unified, as opposed to how the origin text was grabbing for They were conflicting each other, in the various texts underneath the umbrella of the origin texts. You know, the B, Aleph, A, D. These texts. They were manuscripts were in disagreement among themselves. But then the text receptus groupings of manuscripts. There was unity among them. You know, those 85% plus 85% of the manuscripts. That are the TR based. There's agreement, strong agreement among them. There may be areas where there's small areas of disagreement, but you know, as we spoke about briefly today and last week, you know, how being Aleph, how there's contradictions in about 3,000 times in the Gospels,
Gospels alone,
and so, and again, it goes back to these pillars, the Westcon Horn on page 96. That's the pillar of Westcon Horn theory regarding characteristics of the received text are not never found prior to 350, has completely crumbled in light of the evidence. So the fact that said that they didn't exist, they were saying they didn't come into existence until 405, but yet or before 350, you know, however you want to say it, but yet it's been demonstrated it's wrong. You know, overwhelmingly wrong, that it does exist. It did exist, and it still does exist. He says not only was the TR in existence, but was prominent during that particular time period that's being considered. Now, as far as examples, he gives some examples here. we have a quote here from what D.R. Carson says. He says there is no unambiguous evidence that the Byzantine type text was known before the middle of the 4th century. Okay, so
this sounds like Hort's.
It does. He's just talking about Hort's pillar. I guess he still wants to hold on to Hort's pillar and wants to stand on it. Let's let him stand on it and see what happens to him. Who has Matthew Mark, I guess. Mark chapter 1 and 2. Who's got Mark? Mark chapter 1, verses 1 and 2.
The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in the prophets, Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee.
Now, it says written in the prophets. Now, the origin, text of origin, and of his origin's disciples, Westcott and Hort, it says written in the prophets. This is what a modern Bible says. Listen to what the difference is. This is a quote from a modern Bible version. In the beginning of the gospel, Jesus Christ, Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet. Now, what's the difference between saying written in the prophets versus written in Isaiah the prophet? Anna?
Well, it just says in the prophets. It might not be in Isaiah the prophets. I don't think it is. I think it's in Malachi, isn't it?
It is in Malachi, and it's in Isaiah.
Oh, it's in Malachi.
It's in Malachi.
So it's the same prophet, so it is in
Malachi 3:1 and Isaiah 40. Isaiah chapter 40. It's a quote from both of us by Isaiah 40, verse 3. So it's in both.
It's two quotes.
So it's in both. But it is written in the prophets. But the origin text wants to limit it just to
one.
To one. And this is discovered in the writings of Irenaeus, who lived in the second century. He died kind of in the right there at the beginning of the third century. But he lived in the second century. Well, what did D.A. Carson say? What did Westcott Hort say? No TR readings can be found prior to 350 or prior to 400. Because we have this one person, he was the first one to do it. Well, I guess they don't know who, they even looked at this. So that's a problem. It does exist. Now, let's look at Mark chapter 16, verse 19. Who has that one?
Mark 16, 19?
Yes.
I have it. So then, after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God.
And now I think verse 19 is missing in some, either B, Aleph, D, or A, or one of those favorite texts of origin of Westcott Hort. But yet it's found in the text receptus. It's found, it's demonstrated by the fact that long before they believed the textus receptus existed, it's found in the writings of Irenaeus. Who has, Luke chapter 22, verses 42 to 44.
Why is everyone giving
these
so
neat?
I'm sorry, I should have shuffled them that way that when this wouldn't happen.
Well, you know what we could do is, Anna, after you're done reading your verses, I'll switch with you.
That would be fair.
Same. Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And there appeared an angel unto him from heaven, strengthening him. And being in an agony, he prayed more earnestly. And his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling down to the ground.
And so this is another area where the church fathers have it properly. Origin text, the Westcott Hort text, they do not have it. Let's look at another, that was Justin that had it in his writings, who was second century. Who has, I guess Anna? John?
No, I don't have it.
Okay.
118.
118, thank you.
No man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him.
All right. Now the text of the, I guess it's the World Council of Christian Churches, the ESV, and of all its supporters, says, now notice what the difference is. This is from the modern Bible that's based upon the origin text, Westcott Hort text, that's endorsed by the modernist World Council of Christian Churches, and sadly by some fundamental Bible-believing Christians. No one has ever seen God, the only God who is at the Father's side. He hath made him known. Now, what's missing?
Only begotten.
That's missing from the modern Bible.
That I am the deity of Christ.
Exactly. Text of origin. They're embracing that the reading of origin over the proper reading that supports the deity of Christ that was in existence prior to 350, D.A. Carson, you know, or Westcott Horde. It was in existence prior to that time period. Now let's look over it. Another one here. John 3:13. I'm sorry. John 3:13.
And no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man, which is in heaven.
All right, now, again, the WCC text of origin, says, no one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. Now, what's missing is which is in heaven.
That's interesting.
Which is in heaven.
Right. Today,
exactly.
For
mm-hmm. And in the part of it's denying his eternal sonship, perhaps as well.
Yep.
Omniscience.
Yes, his omniscience. That's right. That's right.
That verse, because I think I remember her saying that they were talking about that in a group at Rutgers.
Okay, they were, weren't they?
Well,
I think
she
so.
She doesn't remember right. That.
I probably remember it if I tried.
But that could be why they didn't understand it. If they were reading the King James, and then they were used to using modern Bibles,
mm-hmm.
then they didn't get it.
That's right. Who has John 5, verses 3 to 4? John.
In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole of whatsoever disease he had.
Okay, now, thank you. Now, do you know what the text of origin says, the text of Westcott Horde says, the text of the World Council of Christian Churches says, the text of many organizations that claim to be fundamental and Bible-believing, it says, listen to it, it's missing part of verse 3, and it's missing all of verse 4. Their text, their text of origin says, in these lay a multitude of individuals, blind, lame, and paralyzed. That's it. That's all it says. So what's missing is the fact, waiting for the moving of the water, mm-hmm. for an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water, whosoever then first, after the troubling of the water, stepped into the water was made whole.
Denying miracles.
They are. And they're trying to use human reasoning. I was in a class one time. I was in the same class. I don't know if I remember this conversation or not. But another student that was in the class with me, I heard him. He gave her an account of a discussion we had. The teacher had about this class, and the teacher was dismissing it because it was unreasonable, and he attributed to, I guess, some form of superstition. Which is very, was very, very peculiar, truly peculiar.
Christian teacher?
Yes. Using a modernist commentary, Stott's commentary, but nonetheless, it was the words the teacher was saying, not Stott, I guess it was, John Stott. I'm not sure if his name is Stott. His first, last name is Stott. First name is John, maybe,
yeah,
or John Stott, who wrote a commentary in the Gospel of John. But the point being is, if it's in the Bible, if it is in the text of Scripture, this wasn't anything that was added. This was taken away because Origen, Westcott and Hort, The World Council of Christian Churches want to go along with the fact, and sadly, some, I don't know if they want to be called fundamental anymore, fundamental schools, some Bible-believing churches have gone along with it, gone along with the thinking of Origen in the removal of these verses. Who has John 6:69?
And we believe and are sure that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God.
All right. Now, the modern Bible says,
if it even has it,
and we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God, living God. They removed the Westcott origin. They removed living God.
So it says God.
Yes. They remove living. They remove living. I mean, they have Holy One of God, but they don't have the word the living God.
They don't have Christ.
Not a deity.
Yes.
The Son.
They don't have Christ, and they're right. You're right. They missed that too. Yeah. The King James says, which is an accurate translation of the text Receptus, and we believe and are sure that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then in the modern Bible, the ESV, the Bible of the World Council of Christian Churches, which is, I've already said it before, but and we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God.
So he could just be a prophet,
right.
A priest, mm-hmm. Anybody who just...
That's right.
Deny the deity.
Exactly, that's what they're doing. Denying the deity of Jesus Christ. Who's that, John 14:17?
Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth in you, and shall be in you.
All right, so this is accurately represented in Papyri 66, right around 200 AD or so, as far as shall be in you. There's where that the dispute is, shall be in you. Acts 8:36.
What did you tell us about that verse?
Yeah, they're
they just don't mean
shall be in you. Well, I think the problem is in the Greek. I think in some of the Greek of origin, it's missing shall be in you. The modern Bibles they've kind of been convinced to kind of have it in there in part. But in their Greek texts that they are supporting, Westcott or texts of origin, Westcott or types of texts, some of those manuscripts it's missing. But it's in Papyri 66.
Yeah, so they're denying the indwelling Holy Spirit, which takes away any power we're going to have as Christians.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And basically any hope.
Right.
You know, mm-hmm. It's all got to be man-based, on man's mm-hmm. own power.
That's right. That's right.
Opens it up to humanism.
It does.
8:36-37.
Yes.
And as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? And Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God.
All right. And so, if you have a modern Bible today, look in that modern Bible and look up Acts 8:36-37 and you'll see verse 36 is present. You'll have perhaps you'll have number 37 there and you'll have verse 38. But there'll be nothing beside 37. Verse 37 is missing. Verse 37, which says again, and Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And the answer is that I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. So it's taken away personal belief in the Lord Jesus Christ, and it's taken away the deity of Jesus Christ.
Yeah, that was the part they really wanted to get out of.
Yes.
Last part.
Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
Jesus Christ is the Son of God.
Mm-hmm. They want to get rid of it completely. 1 Timothy 3:16.
And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh.
Justify the Spirit.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I just read it out of the book here rather
okay.
than up in the Bible.
Seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, okay. believed on in the world, received up in the glory. But yeah, that was the main, that's the main part of the verse there they were going to discuss here. But in a modern Bible version, the version of origin, not the version of origin, the text of origin, the text of Westcon Hort, the ones that modern Bible versions are based upon, the ESV, the translation of the World Council of Christian Churches, it's based upon their translation at least, and it's embraced by prominent, fundamental, or once fundamental schools in South Carolina, Bob Jones University. I've been to the campus, of course I've been to the campus, but as far as I'm told, the bookstores is favoring this particular translation or this particular version of Scripture. And this is off subject slightly, but this translation, the ESV, is based upon the RSV, the Revised Standard Version. And the Revised Standard Version came out in the 50s, I think, or thereabouts. That was entirely rejected by the founder, if not the founder, the founder's son of that school. I think Bob Jones Sr. perhaps was vehemently opposed to the RSV and its association with the World Council of Christian Churches and its association with modernism, not to mention the fact its association with the wrong, corrupted Greek text of origin in Westcott and Hort. But so nonetheless, what's missing in this ESV is, listen to what's missing. The ESV says, great indeed, we confess, is the mystery of godliness. He was manifest in the flesh, vindicated by the Spirit, seen by angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed on in the world, taken up to glory. Now, what is wrong with the verse in the modern Bible translation here? Let's focus on the word, he was manifest in the flesh.
The deity of Christ is removed.
The deity of Christ is removed. God was manifest in the flesh versus he was manifested in the flesh.
Right.
I mean, it
says that Jesus is not God.
Right.
That's what their translation says.
Mm-hmm.
Takes away his deity. That also takes away... Notice the change at the very end. It says in the King James, received up in the glory. I think yours, the one that you quoted, the ESV says.
It says, taken up in glory, versus received.
Right, there's a difference in there. They have a doctrinal difference there.
Right, that's good. That's a good observation. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, makes a big difference.
Right.
Taken up, okay, the Lord brought him up, but he was received. Why was he received? He is the Son of God.
Yes, that's right.
The Lamb that takes away the sin of the world.
Mm-hmm.
He was accepted as a substitute for us. You know, if he was taken up, he'd be like anyone, like prophets in the Old Testament.
Right. That's right. Ephesians 1:1.
Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and the faithful in Christ Jesus.
And there's a problem with this too, in the texts of origin. Let's look at 1 Timothy 3:16.
What's the problem?
I think it's missing in some of the, either B, Aleph, A, or D.
Verse is missing?
It's not, maybe not entirely missing, but there's a problem with God was in the flesh. They're looking at the fact...
God was in the flesh. It's not in this verse.
Yeah, we were looking at Ephesians 1:1, right?
Ephesians 1:1.
Yeah, that's right. Well, there is a dispute. I don't have the exact dispute. I'm sorry. 1 Timothy 3:16.
and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory.
We just did that one.
Yeah.
Oh, we did. Okay, I'm sorry. I did it twice. I'm sorry about that. But as far as getting back to that Ephesians passage, I think it should have been verse 7. Read verse 7.
In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace.
Okay.
Yeah, I can see where they want to get rid of that.
I think isn't it a book? Isn't that the book?
That is the book, yeah.
That Ephesians had to be.
Yeah, volume 1. Okay, so
it's not referring to Ephesians.
Right, that's right. So I'm thinking maybe maybe that goes back to in this writing by Ignatius, this verse in 1 Timothy 3:16 is there. That's what that is,
he
probably.
Said God was in the flesh in his writings and to the Ephesians.
Yes, okay.
So that shows, demonstrates that it did say God.
Right, okay. 1 John 5:7-8.
For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. And there are three that bear witness in the earth, the Spirit, and the water, and the blood, and these three agents agree in one. Or these three agree in one.
Okay, that was something in the book? That was in the book?
No, he just read it wrong.
No, I just read it.
Oh, okay, got it, okay. I understand. Now, you know what happens here in the modern Bible, in the text of origin, the text of the version of BJU Bookstore?
Mm-hmm. They're lucky if they're in there.
They omit them.
They remove verse, they take part of verse 7 away, and they erase all of verse 8. The modern Bible says, for there are three that testify. And they also kind of play a game here. They kind of are repositioning, they're breaking the verse in parts and making there are three that testify. That's verse 7. For verse 7, they have there are three that testify. And in verse 8, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and these three agree. And so they're taking away.
Doctrine of the Trinity.
Trinity. What else?
They also take deity of Christ.
Deity of Christ, right?
They also. Take away that the Word itself and Jesus are one.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You know, as John 1:1 tells them, be those Word words with God.
Yes,
the Word
that's
was
right.
God.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the same was in the beginning with God. So. By extension, it also takes away his.
And the cross.
His. Words slipped my mind.
Cross, that's right.
Eternality of Christ.
Right.
Because it says the blood.
Eternal sonship, yeah.
Yeah.
Right, eternal, yeah. Eternality. The blood, they remove the blood.
The
that's
cross,
good.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm, the cross. But yet, this verse is found in the writings of. In third century writings of one of the patristic fathers. Let's look at Revelation. 22:14.
Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city.
Okay. Now, I believe it's not, there are some that say that they change the word tree to book, I believe, if my thinking is correct here. They make that change. But yet, this is a disputed verse by Origen. By Westcott Hort, by the modernistic translations, and by extension, anyone that would perhaps support those modernistic translations. And we're looking in 2 Peter 3:16. Where's that one?
I got it. As also in his epistle, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also the other scriptures unto their own destruction.
All right, so we have here this verse that's perhaps that reminds us that the people twist the scriptures. And certainly that's what Origen was doing, that's what Westcott were doing. In the modern-day Bibles, when they reject the fact of the existence of the readings of the text receptus, that's what they're doing. They're twisting, they're resting the scriptures.
Is there a change in that one? Or no?
No, I don't believe so. Not a substantial change.
It's referring to Paul's epistles, right?
Right. Mm-hmm. Now, Tertullian said, "Now this heresy of yours does not receive certain scriptures, and whichever of them it does receive, it perverts by means of additions and diminutions for the accomplishment of its own purpose." And so even Tertullian is noting the fact of this problem with the doctrine of Scripture. Thoughts about this section? Mrs. Grummer, thoughts you might have? If anyone wants to send us an email with their thoughts, they may do so to questions at bftbc.org. That's questions at bftbc.org. Or give a phone call at the regular phone call here at the desk or at the office. Go, Mrs. Grummer, your thoughts about this section here? Kind of some extra details we had today.
Well, I was just thinking as we were going through these verses and things, how important that defending the King James Bible is.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The meanings, yeah. The Bergen meanings. That's all.
Good. Jacob, how about you?
Mm-hmm. But I guess that's for somebody that's studying this should know, though.
Right. I mean, go ahead, Jacob.
I imagine a lot of these are in the back of this defined King James Bible right there,
That's right. Some of them might be, Jacob.
I imagine they probably are.
John, how about you? Thoughts you have?
Well, you can clearly see from the evidence shown that the Textus Receptus was around from very early on.
Yes.
Those readings, in spite of what the so-called scholars are trying to tell you, including mm-hmm. some of the early church scholars who clearly from some of their writings were twisting the scripture.
Right, right. Call from Virginia. What are your thoughts about this?
Hi, this is Dan Longway. You're listening from Virginia, Roanoke, Virginia. Thank you very much for your class.
Well, good. I'm glad you're listening. Thanks. Thanks, Dad, for listening.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Yep. Good.
Thanks, bye. If I had looked ahead of time, this would have been a great day to have my 26 translation.
Yes, that's right.
Uh-huh. It would show you the changes.
Yeah.
You would look up that verse, and you could see from 26 mm-hmm. translations what's changed, deleted.
Right, right.
Or if it's not there, it means the verse isn't there.
Yes, that's right, mm-hmm. Bill, your thoughts?
Pretty much the same as previous weeks, mm-hmm. where knowledge is growing.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And understanding how people would make mistakes.
Right.
But the most amazing thing to me is that people deliberately make mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
Deliberately sabotage God's word. You wonder why.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It makes no sense.
Right.
It must be the original Democrats.
Maybe.
Yeah, we have such a warning in Scripture against that.
Tammy, your thoughts?
It's just interesting that, these are the people that really weren't necessarily sound in their doctrine. Although there were some, but there were people like Justin Martyr. He wasn't sound, and yet he was quoting from...
Yeah.
the TR. He wasn't quoting, you know, from something else.
Right.
Which, I mean, that in and of itself should be enough evidence to show somebody that doesn't understand.
Right.
Because it's, they don't, it's not, they're not trying to push certain agenda.
Right. That's right. Well, they're not, are they? So it was good to look at these verses. And are they on line 2? Is it line 2? If it's on line 2, I get the question right here. Hello, yes.
And this is a question, it's not related to the class, it was related to the,
Okay, well, we get the phone number, we'll have to call you back. I'm in the middle of teaching a class here. I thought you had a question, we're watching the class today about our history of the Bible class. Go ahead, Anna, I'm sorry for interrupting here.
Okay, wait, one moment.
Sorry about that. I thought someone had a question about what we're talking about today when they called the office. But any more thoughts or observations about this class? It was good, John.
Well, I can't find the verse I'm thinking of, but even in Paul's writing, the Apostle Paul told us at his time the corruption and that was happening in the church and in the scriptures that they had at that time. So we're talking about in the days of the apostles. It was taking place. That's where it started.
Tammy.
Oh, I wanted to mention Dr. Mormon's new book.
Yes.
The Early Church Fathers. I had it. I thought I grabbed it, but I grabbed the other book.
Okay.
It has a pretty nice section in there about the Church Fathers. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I mean, obviously, that's the title of it.
Right.
But as far as, you know, that's what I wanted to bring it, because I didn't get a chance to look at it in depth. But, it might be something that we might like to look at in general.
Okay, we might like to look at that. Jacob, go ahead.
Mister, I wanted to ask, John, what is that comparative Bible you were talking about that compares these verses? What's the name of it?
Oh, I have a 26th translation Bible. It's out of print. As far as I know, you might be able to find. You can try looking on Amazon or something, but
Baptist Inc. They sell a lot of used books there.
Is it parallel, John?
Yeah, that should give you all 26. You look, it'll give you all 26 translations of this verse and then the next verse.
All on one page, maybe.
Yeah, right?
All one page. All on one page, they have.
So verse one.
One verse.
Verse two, whatever.
Yeah, you might have a couple of verses on a page, but it'll go verse by verse.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know,
I was talking with somebody at Hastings Bookstore over here in town when I was in the section with, you know, all the Bible stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't
seem like very much of a
Christian
as far as like an appearance,
but he knew how important this issue
was. You know, there's a lot of secular
people
out there that have more discernment than people that are, you know, going to church every weekend. Mm, that's something.
It is something.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Not hard to see.
Right. Right. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, let's close with prayer. Father, we want to thank you today for the study. We ask you to help Pastor and Mrs. White be safe there in Virginia. Please give them good meetings, the one that's this evening and Saturday and on Sunday and on Monday as well. And we do ask that you would be with the services this Sunday here. And we'd ask that thou would encourage us with thy word, convict this of our sin. We do ask that we be able to stand for the truth of thy word. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, I do have a quiz here for everybody.